If you have been paying attention up to now, you should be able to pass the following quiz. What famous geometrical figure is this? What is it called? No, really famous. We are talking famous on the level of Shakespeare, Beethoven, possibly even Michael Jackson. Spoiler alert. That's right. It's a triangle. Three sides, three corners. Oh, you learned in grade school that a triangle looked like this? Then you have not been updating. Your petty bourgeois mindset is still entrenched in the thought forms of the previous cultural epoch. Get with the program, people. Expand your consciousness. How many separate districts are the points of this plane divided into? This one is easy to see. That means a point could wander around in here without crossing a line. How about this one? Hint, a point, as we have noticed before, doesn't mind journeying through infinity. Right. And likewise the others. Any two point fields share a line segment as a boundary. That makes six boundaries. Each side of the triangle is divided into two segments by its two corners. And each of these six segments is one of the boundaries. The three boundary segments that pass through infinity and return from the other side appear to execute some kind of a flip. For instance, in the upper part of the figure, red lies to the left of violet. In the lower part, to the right. We can now formulate this statement. Three non-concurrent lines divide the plane into four fields of points. Each field has three sides and three corners. Yes, all four zones are triangular. Not only the neatly limited central triangle, which of course is good for grade school children, because it is so firmly incarnated, but also the three peripheral triangles. Or you might prefer to say trilaterals, since the sides are operative. As we saw the first time, polarizing gives you a new and often surprising truth, completely free of charge. Let's try it on this one. Remember, to polarize a proposition about a figure in a plane, interchange the terms point and line. If you want to try it, pause now. So three non-collinear points divide the plane into four fields of lines. Each field has three corners and three sides. If you want to try to understand that on your own and draw it, pause now. That means a line could slide around in here without crossing a point. Or likewise here, or here. Where is the fourth zone? Pause if you like. Each Each triangular line field is the negative of one of the point fields on the left, and conversely, the point fields are convex. The line fields are concave. That is because the point exerts centralizing forces. For instance, we speak of the center of gravity. Projective morphology can develop the complementary idea of the axis of levity, or in space, the plane of levity. This has far-reaching consequences for the natural sciences, currently so one-sidedly fixed on central material forces, as first shown by Georg Kaufmann, who went by George Adams, and Olive Whitcher. All right, let's mobilize our thinking. What happens if one of the corners goes for a walk? Feel free to draw it and color it in. The corner is already infinitely distant. No need to show you all the intermediate stages. Objection. Shouldn't the yellow and red fields merge at this stage? Wrong. They are separated by the third corner of the triangle, where the parallels cross in the infinite distance. Soon the moving corner will draw even with the other two. What will happen then? Pause if you like. All three lines coincide. Three of the four fields have collapsed. What? Now come on, how did you get that? If you go back two pictures and think it in movement, you will see that the central red field has now decollapsed. To put it topologically, the horizontal line, and with it, the red-yellow boundary and the green-violet boundary, remains in place throughout the metamorphosis. The other four boundaries rotate. The red-green boundary, for instance, has rotated through the horizontal, so have the other three. By passing through the inner infinitude of the collapsed state, the whole figure has flipped. So now we're back to the same figure we started with. Or is it? Yes, all the distances and measurements are the same, but please check the colors. The figure we began with has been turned inside out. Metamorphosis, in the proper sense, is more than just a shift. It involves thorough transformation. No need to stop here. Now we're back. Next challenge. You must have seen this coming, right? The metamorphosis of the four fields of lines as one corner of the triangle passes through infinity. If you want to picture it or draw it on your own, pause now. Was that too sudden? You might need to go back and make sure you can picture the continual change from the previous figure to this one. As Rudolf Steiner notes in The Philosophy of Spiritual Activity, that is, of inner freeness, in chapter 5 and in the first appendix, the perceptual world is intermittent. Thinking makes it continual. One of the line fields is on its way to getting flattened. Can you see which one? The entire population of the yellow line field has collapsed into a single line, which, however, is too thin to be visible here, just like the collapsed point fields in the polar figure. Is this step verifiable? It may help to note that the green field of lines, for instance, is always bounded by the left-hand corner on the one hand and the other two on the other, even when it occupies the whole plane, as in the previous picture. With the violet field, it is the right-hand corner. The red field was outside the three corners in both of the previous pictures and remains so now. The moving corner pushed the yellow field and is now pulling it. Throughout the metamorphosis, the moving corner is the one preventing the yellow field from merging with the red. For those of you who want it stated precisely, each corner of the triangle is divided by the two sides passing through it into what we may call two point segments, that is, two angular sweeps, each in the shape of half of an X, and any two line fields are separated by such a point segment. This X flattened out when the moving corner passed between the other two. That is how the yellow field was annihilated and has now passed through the inner infinitude of nothingness to emerge flipped on the other side. Only now is the metamorphosis complete. And in case you have too much time on your hands, you could try moving one of the sides instead. Let it slide out into the distance, coalesce with the infinitely distant line of the plane, and return from the opposite direction. What does that do to the point fields? What does it do to the line fields? That should keep you busy. If you rotate a line 180 degrees, does it return to its original position? Or do you have to rotate it 360 degrees? It seems worth noting that in today's exercise, we had to send that point through infinity twice to return to the original situation. Things tend to flip when they pass through infinity. If you and your friend walk out side by side on parallel lines, pass through infinity, and return from the opposite direction. Do you switch lines? Because those lines cross out there, remember? But that would mean the friend who started on the left is now on the right. And worse, it would mean a line does not return into itself, but into some other line parallel to it, which is obviously wrong. To be consistent, you might find yourselves compelled to walk upside down on the way back, hanging from the soles of your feet like an Australian. But don't worry, you and your friend can right yourselves by continuing calmly and passing through infinity a second time. Anyway, that's just a hypothetical question, since if you're watching this, you are obviously some kind of hardcore geometry geek, and therefore don't have any friends. Bye for now.